Hi, I'm Norah Jones, and today I'm playing along with Andrew Bird.
I'm just playing along. Do 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 do. I do 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 with you. Do 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 do.
I'm just playing along with you. I'm just playing along with you.
Hey, I'm Norah Jones. With me, as always, is Sarah Oda.
Welcome to our show.
Hello. And hello to you and you and you.
Our guest today is the endlessly talented multi-instrumentalist and singer-songwriter Andrew Bird.
Oh, he's so great. This was a fun one.
Yeah, he's an incredible violin player. He's very skilled in using a loop pedal, has a beautiful voice, and my favorite is his whistling.
He whistles like nobody else, and it's a big part of his music, and we talk about that. And I've never met Andrew Bird until this podcast, but I've been a fan for 20 years, we figured out, which is crazy because I feel like I'm 20, but I'm not.
He's put out 16 studio albums, and that doesn't even include the live albums and EPs he's also released. You'll hear about his evolution from playing violin at a very young age.
Yeah.
All the way through.
Yeah.
Yeah. All the way through his finest work yet.
Yeah, he's a cool guy, and this is a fun one. Fun one!
This is our first violinist, which is, I love, because, you know, I played violin and viola when I was littler, and, you know, through high school and stuff, and it's like, I felt like I got wedged into just the technical level of it being so perfect all the time, and, like, the competition of, like, it was all about just getting the little medals and doing well in these, like, performances, and it was never about enjoying it, and it took a lot of the fun out for me, and I feel like that's kind of why I kind of fell off of doing it.
Wow.
But I feel like if I heard Andrew Bird when I was little and thought, oh, that's something I can do with violin, awesome, like I'll stay with it, but I didn't know that.
Yeah,
I feel like I missed the boat.
That's too bad. Well, you can still play though. I've heard you. I heard you on a little demo. Yep, I heard you. You can still do it. Can you whistle?
I can.
Let's hear you.
But
I mean, you're no Andrew Bird.
Wait, give me a song. I don't have, like,
I don't know. Maybe we should save the whistling for the
oh! It's my birthday.
So sad.
You did it though.
But I did it inhaling, and then I had too much air, and I couldn't exhale quick enough
to get
more. I'm
confused about why you could whistle in but not out. It's the same.
Me too, my friend.
Embouchure.
Did you learn that word? Embouchure. That was me whistling in, and here's me whistling out. I can't do it. I've tried.
Try moving your tongue around.
Maybe we should get to that episode.
Oh God, I wish people could have seen what you just did.
I'm sure they could hear it. There's nothing awkward. There's nothing better than mouth noise on a mic. That's like an album title. Okay, well,
this episode is packed full of songs.
Yeah, there's more music in this episode than most. And we had a really good time. I think we do mostly, yeah, it's all his songs. And well, I'm not going to tell you. Never mind.
Sit back and enjoy.
There's a little surprise nugget in there. Please enjoy the incredible Andrew Bird.
She's alone, she's alone, lone, lone Didion. She's alone, she's alone, lone, lone Didion. Get along without her. Get along without him. Lone Didion. Every Saturday night she came in with him. Table six in the back, tall beer and a gin. Now she comes in alone, lone Didion. When he lies, says he'll keep you safe. say fall. And it leaves and it makes you pay for your gin. Now she comes in alone. Don't Didion.
Song.
Thanks.
That's from your new album.
It
right?
is. Yeah.
It came out last year?
Came out. I've lost all sense of time.
Oh, yeah. Passing. I'm with you.
But I think it was last spring. Yeah.
Okay. Did you write it all during the COVID times or before?
Some of it before. That one I think was written during. I was reading a lot of Joan Didion.
I was going to ask.
Yeah.
Obviously.
But yeah, it also goes back to a story of a friend of mine who used to work at. Yeah, I'm sure you know Balthazar.
Yeah.
I used to seat them. Joan Didion and her husband. They had like a regular table.
That's kind of how I pictured it when I was imagining what this was about.
Yeah.
I was picturing her in a restaurant.
Yeah.
Yeah. It paints the picture.
Yeah. But then it was in, I think, 2003 or 2004 when she would seat them as the maitre d', you know, like every Saturday night. And they had they ordered the same thing, got the same drinks. And then they didn't come in for... like 2 months, and then she came in alone.
Oh, God.
It was right when all that was going down.
I read that book.
Yeah.
Your Magical Thinking.
Yeah.
God, that's so heartbreaking.
I know.
Well, I love how this song paints it, though. You know, she would love this.
I wasn't sure. I felt a little guilty about it, like I was violating her privacy in some way, but given that there's that inside.
I feel like it's poetically pleasing to someone of her aesthetic, you know. Mm-hmm. I think it's kind of beautiful, but
I couldn't hear that story and not do something
with
it, because it affected me so much, you know.
It's really beautiful. Yeah.
Good.
This song is Manifest.
Mm-hmm.
Which album is this from?
My Finest Work Yet.
Best album title ever. Feel like that about every album, though, in general?
Well, I was just when you get to album number 15 or 16, you're like, who are we kidding?
I know. Like,
of course.
Why do I keep trying to?
Because people would always ask if this is this your definitive record or whatever.
Exactly.
And I was like, Sure. Sure it is. You bet.
How many albums have you put out?
I think 16.
It's crazy.
Sorry. Okay.
That sounds good.
I'm coming to the edge of the widest canyon, my companion's dear. Starting to question my manifest destiny, my claim to this frontier. I'm coming to the brink of a great disaster, and just has to be near. The earth spins faster, whistles right past you, whispers death in your ear. Don't pretend you can't hear. Don't pretend you can't. What this earth wants living, then to be exhumed and burned to vapor. Can we save her? Now she's in the air, radical and free. Neither here nor there. She's a blast to no one, a blast to no one. Well, I'm coming to the an ocean, such commotion and fear, keeping all our eyes on what's on the horizon and all that we hold dear. I'm coming to the brink of a great disaster, and just has to be near. The earth spins faster, whistles right past you, whispers death in your ear. Don't pretend you can't hear. Don't pretend you can't. Supply. here. Don't pretend you care.
Man.
That's fun.
Your way of playing piano is perfect for that song.
Oh, thanks. You know, I love that, playing that,
that
song.
That, I don't know, what'd you call it? A little bit of like Memphis, dusty.
Oh, yeah.
You know? Yeah. I was working on it this morning and I was like, oh, yeah, you're a perfect partner.
You picked
for this.
The perfect songs for us together, I think.
Yeah. I was thinking this one and then Armchairs, which is one I hardly ever play.
I love
it's so
that song.
Sprawling.
And, yeah, it's haunting.
But it's such a long, linear song, you know?
It is, but it's so beautiful, and it's like a whole journey,
yeah.
You know?
But
I like songs like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I remember recording that years ago, and I was telling you earlier, I don't play piano because my hand turns purple because I'm contort to play the violin for so many years that when I turn it the other way, it cuts off the circulation, but...
It's horrible.
I was obsessed with how the piano should sound on Armchairs with that kind of octave thing.
I love that
part. So I just
part.
Ended up playing it myself. Cause it,
did you play it like with two fingers?
I think I had to do overdubs. Is that sad? Like,
No, it's not. I think that some of my favorite piano parts in recorded history are from people who don't normally play the piano. You know, they're very simple.
Yeah, yeah.
And I like, it's more melodic sometimes in that way.
It's true. Like sometimes... Piano can go wrong pretty easily when you have too much at your disposal. But but that I always loved that I guess they call it countrypolitan style of like the Nashville, that octave melody.
Yeah, I think I know what you're talking about. I've never heard it called that. Did you say Peloton?
Countrypolitan.
Countrypolitan. I thought I was thinking about the exercise bike for a second.
No.
Countrypolitan. I've never heard that. Like the Floyd Kramer kind of vibe. Or it's different.
Who's the guy? There was a piano player that in the era of Shel Silverstein, that kind of hippie era of Nashville.
Uh-huh.
It was named like Pig or something was his name?
I don't know.
A session guy. And he would do that kind of rolling octave thing that like, became like, kind of part of...
That kind of thing?
That, but more in the low end.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm trying to think who's the best example of that sound. I think it's kind of like a... Early 70s, like beautiful production.
I love that. I must know it. I just don't know exactly the term to put to the thing that I probably know in my brain somewhere.
But the theme to Armchairs is that.
I love it.
Yeah. Should we do that one?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay.
Okay. In the beginning, do you do the ambient stuff or you want me to do a little something and then.
I mean, I could.
Were you going to do it on violin? I think that would be cool. And then let me do the.
Yeah, yeah.
You can switch while I'm doing that.
It's a loop that I can just cue up.
I think that would be cool.
Yeah, let me switch to the other violin. Okay. I dreamed you were a cosmonaut, the space between our chairs. And I was the cartographer of the tangles in your hair. I
saddest song is silencing. It's the one that everybody knows. Oh, everybody knows the song that silence sings. And this is how it goes. Apocrypha, they're hanging from a strand. Dark and empty rooms are full of incandescent hands. An awkward pause, a fatal flaw, time. It's a crooked bow. Time's a crooked bow. Time, you need to learn to love the ebb just like the flow. Grab hold of your bootstraps and pull like hell till gravity feels sorry for you, lets you go as if you lack the proper chemicals to know. Oh, the way it felt the last time you let yourself fall. Five and 3/8 years later, at the bottom of a gigantic crater, an armchair calls to you. Oh, this armchair calls to you, and it says that someday we'll get back at them all with epoxy and a pair of pliers. As ancient sea slugs begin to crawl through the ragweed and barbed wire.
so pretty.
It's like I said, it's sprawling.
It's sprawling.
That's it. That's the sound. That's the countrypolitan sound.
Is it?
Here I'm talking about countrypolitan. I'm not a music historian, but I have heard that phrase before.
I guess I have.
Yeah.
I think I know what you're talking about now.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's beautiful. I love this. Can we do a gig now?
Yeah.
We should do some gigs.
I don't know why we haven't done one up until now.
I can't believe we've never met. Yeah. I got your first album in 2003 and I was really into it. And I've been a fan for, it's 20 years ago. That's insane.
That's insane.
I can't even believe that.
I know.
Yeah. I love it. Where did you come from? Where do you come from?
I come from France. No, I from Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah. Grew up there. My mom is an artist and she imagined all her kids playing classical music. So
wow.
I started Suzuki when I was 4.
Oh, wow.
And I'm the only one that kind of stuck with it. And,
how many siblings?
3 other siblings.
Okay. That's a big family.
Yeah. It was like twice a week I would go to the group lesson and then the private lesson, and my mom just, she got a violin to learn with me.
Oh my gosh, that's
what
a
they
really
said.
Sweet bonding thing.
Yeah, so it's not an antagonistic thing, like.
Yeah, you must practice.
And then you're like, why don't you practice?
Yeah, exactly. That's a really good idea, actually.
Yeah.
I want to do that with my kids.
Yeah,
I'm going to steal that.
It works when they're really young, but
yeah.
Like with my kid, like he doesn't like me to play violin with him. Like he plays guitar and just now he's 11, like he's letting me jam with him on violin.
But he's like, keep it cool, Dad.
He'd prefer me to be inferior on the guitar with him, which I am already.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
It's funny the dynamic that happens.
Yeah.
But that's really cool. How long did she play with you, or did she stop after the
pretty
beginning?
Pretty soon after, yeah.
Okay, but that's still a really nice entry and a nice way to bond with your parent.
Yeah, it was good. And I remember I would always be like, okay, now play minuet 1. And this is all by ear, which is the idea of Suzuki.
Okay, I was going to ask because I know of it, but I don't really know. That's what I thought, though.
Yeah, which is a complaint that people have about it, but I think it's like the whole point.
Well, it's great for young kids. That's the whole point, right?
Yeah. And so I would be like, oh, she'd say, play minuet 1. I'd be like, how does it go? And then she'd like go, yeah, da 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 dee. Like she'd just get carried away singing it for me. And
I'd be like, your mom?
Oh. Yeah. And I'd be like, I got it. Like,
that's really sweet. But that's funny because Suzuki is a classical method.
Yeah, but there's folk tunes in there,
okay,
too.
Okay, because I was going to say, it seems really good to set somebody up for playing non-classical music.
It is key for me.
Yeah.
To get
it makes your ears huge, right?
Huge. So much so that my ear could always learn things faster than my brain could with sight reading. But it got extreme when I'd be in an orchestra and I'd have to learn Strauss's Don Juan, which is like a page of black notes, you know, and I couldn't really sight read well enough. So I'd get those tapes. You could buy cassette tapes that would loop and they would play the same passage over and over again.
Man.
And I would play it when I went to sleep.
And that's how you learned it.
That's how I learned it.
That's cool. It kind of sets up my whole image of how you play and it makes a lot of sense.
Right. And then once I got out of music school, I rarely had to read or needed or wanted to read anything.
Reading is hard for me. My kids are taking piano now and it's super simple so I can read it. But when it gets to two-handed, many notes, I'm like, I learned that way, but not really since I was 8th grade maybe. I kind of started reading chord charts after that and that's just so much easier for me.
Yeah, yeah.
But were you in bands and did you go to college?
Yeah, I went to Northwestern Music School.
Is that a broad music school or is it mostly classical?
It was mostly classical.
Okay.
They had a small jazz program, but it wasn't very far along. You know, it's like, don't play with vibrato because you won't get the gig, you know, kind of.
Yeah, that's funny.
Like very like dogmatic. Anyway, it was, you know, we could talk about that for a while. I'm sure
I went to jazz school.
Yeah.
But it's different because I'm not a string instrument player.
Right.
But that's funny.
But yeah, I was itching to get out of the Western music thing and in school. And I did study jazz through ethnomusicology because there was a fairly well-known professor there that taught, who studied jazz as an ethnomusicology thing. So we'd have to transcribe Coltrane's Blue Train and various solos. I'd have to learn them. And
was that the first time you were into jazz in high school, or were you hearing it growing up?
I didn't hear it growing up. It took me a while to find the stuff I liked.
Yeah.
Because in college, you just jump right into hard bop.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, here's Giant Steps.
You know,
it's like, wait, where's the history that got us to Giant Steps?
You know? It's like there's a lot of things that led to that for them. Yeah, that's funny. I remember somebody telling me about Giant Steps. I went to Interlochen Arts Camp in high school for 2 years.
And I went there for a summer.
You did?
Yeah.
We weren't there at the same time. But it was fun, right? Did you like it?
No.
You hated it. I loved it. It was like the best summer of my life.
But you went to the school. Did you go to school?
No, I went to the summer.
Okay.
Yeah. Summer camp.
Yeah. If you're in the orchestras were brutal.
Well, it seemed brutal, actually. I get that because I had a lot of classical friends. I was one of very few jazz majors because they had a great jazz program, but it was small. And I loved going to hear the orchestra every week, but yeah, it seemed kind of hard. But I remember this girl who was another one of the few jazz majors. She played Barry sax, and she was a character. And she was like, "I was like, what are you listening to? Oh, I'm learning Giant Steps." And I was like, "Oh, what's that? Cool." And she was like, "You haven't heard of Giant Steps?" I was like, "You know, I'm 15."
Yeah.
And it was kind of a funny introduction to it as well, you know.
Yeah. It kind of all that sort of what we call jock jazz kind of world of like, you know, it's like
technique.
Yeah.
I like when I hear people play Giant Steps as a ballad. It's actually really beautiful.
Yeah, sure.
It's amazing.
I'm getting ready to make a jazz album, so this is great timing.
Oh wow!
Because I've always, I mean, my first couple records were kind of in the jazz idiom to some, but kind of an old timey version of it.
Yeah.
It's like I've had a long relationship with as a listener to jazz. It's just my go-to.
Yeah.
And the particular branch of the jazz tree that I've always loved is like the, you know, you got the, it starts with New Orleans, Sidney Bechet, Louis Armstrong, then the great tenor players like Coleman Hawkins.
I love Coleman Hawkins.
Lester Young is my favorite.
Yeah.
And they go, I'm just kind of ignoring the Charlie Parker part of the tree at this point and going straight to like the mid-50s when those guys were kind of at the end of their career and making really beautiful albums.
Yeah.
But it's mostly those tenor players that I respond to more than
it's jazz. It's like a voice. Yeah. They sound like a singer.
Yeah, because it's the reed, it's the breath.
Yeah, it's very breathy.
And that the phrasing that comes from it being a breath of air, I think that lends to it. And then that kind of rich tone, and that's what I'm trying to, just in the last couple of months, like I'm going back into student mode a little bit.
Yeah.
And trying to like get to another level as an improviser.
Was that something you did a lot early on in college when you were getting into that kind of zone?
I mean, generally, I never have been a great student of music. I've always just got it in my bones enough to get by.
Because you seem like a great improviser, especially when you see you do the loopy stuff, and it seems like it's all improvised.
A lot of it is, but when it comes to those, like I can't tell you that what's happening, this passing chord is like a 13 + 9, like Neapolitan 6, whatever. Like I don't know what's happening in music theory wise, and I don't really, still don't feel like I need to. I just get it in my bones and just play.
There is a lot of math in jazz chord progressions, and it's nice to know a little bit of the basics to feel like you understand what you're doing. But there's also so many great musicians who don't have that, and they're just as amazing. So music is such a funny thing in that way.
It is.
I think.
It is. I guess I've been thinking about this lately. Like I don't want to learn so much math that I would be able to play something beyond what I hear in my head.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Or you know, I feel like also some people learn it all and then you get to the place where you've learned it and you can kind of forget it. Mm-hmm. I think I'm similar to you. I'm a little of a lax student of the technical stuff, you know, but
right.
I love to go with the flow.
I'm with you there.
Hence this. Yeah. And I grew up playing jazz. That was my main thing until after I left North Texas. I went 2 years to jazz school in college, and then I came to New York, and I went to the jazz clubs, and I loved it so much. But then I got into like songwriting and other stuff, and I never had a lot of chops. I could never play fast in that genre, you know, and because I'm the laziest practicer on the planet.
I am too, honestly.
Yeah.
I'm just a free range practicer. I don't stay on task.
Like I'm too distracted. I'm that. But yeah. I think, you know, it takes all kinds. I appreciate people who can do that. Lock themselves in a room. I feel like at Interlochen, I remember a lot of people like that. They were locked in their practice huts in the woods practicing.
Yeah.
Which I still, that's the most sentimental sound to me, just a bunch of people practicing in the woods.
It's either, it's both sentimental and the sound of madness.
Yeah, it is the sound of madness, absolutely.
Yeah.
So you're doing a jazz record, that's very cool.
Yeah, just the first one is going to be my favorite standards.
Yeah. And
the second one is going to be more of a free.
Okay, thing. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I wanted to get through my favorite old classic tunes first.
Some really good ones.
Such as Body and Soul, which is like, I feel like that's, again, the Coleman Hawkins solo on that one is famous.
Yeah.
And it's such a, I've just got into it in the last few years, and I was like, that is about as good as it gets. That's like the best music I've ever heard is the way he plays on that tune. And that's what I mean about going into student mode is like, I want to figure out what he's doing.
Yeah.
And I'm not, it could take a couple more years to really, maybe a lifetime to figure it out, but.
Well, I mean, he was so good, but also he's also just playing from his heart, which is, I think, what it is.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah, totally.
That's the goal, right?
Yeah. I'm trying to connect also, like, all these years of just sitting on the couch writing songs, I've kind of, what I can whistle in my head is way beyond what I can play on my violin these days.
Yeah.
It used to be closer together.
Uh-huh.
So that's kind of where I'm at, trying to connect.
That's funny.
What's in my head to my instrument again.
Where did the whistling come from, by the way? When did you learn to whistle? Could you just always whistle well?
I don't know. I just do it incessantly, like nonstop. It would drive you nuts.
I love it. I can't whistle.
No,
I know they say you just put your lips together and blow, but I've tried my whole life. I can whistle sucking in a little bit, but not out.
Through the teeth at all?
I have teeth.
You have teeth?
Oh, no, I can't whistle through my teeth. Is that whistling? Not really. Anyway, we can go over this later. Maybe you can teach me. Yeah, I feel like I kind of feel like it must be like singing where you just kind of are good at it. It's kind of in you or it's not, maybe, and you get better at it, but
yeah,
maybe it's just something you were born whistling.
I definitely was from an early age, and it's, I didn't put it on albums at first because I thought, you know, whistling's so easy. Why would you do something that's so easy? Or I was afraid it would just be considered like a novelty thing. But then it seemed kind of weird to be whistling all day long and then go in the studio or go on stage and not whistle.
And not whistle.
Like, just, it just seemed conspicuous not to do it.
But it's so cool because your whole thing is really unique and the whistling is part of what makes it unique. And then you don't whistle on every song, but when it comes in, it's like, it's so special, you know?
I think it's because it's just...
It's part of you.
I don't always intend for it. I don't say, oh, here's where I'm going to whistle.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's like my hands are busy playing. And so to carry the melody, here's where the melody goes. I whistle. And it's so much just like what I'd be doing when I was doing the dishes.
Yeah.
That it becomes more honest than anything else.
Yeah. It's just another way of getting at the melody.
Yeah.
It's just you use what you got.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool. You want to try?
What is next?
Is it Lusitania?
Lusitania?
Lusitania.
Do you want to do this one duet? Like, do you know the lyrics?
Yeah, I can do that part. Yeah.
The second verse.
Who sings that on your record?
Annie Clark.
I thought so. That's so funny. I was like, man, that sounds like Annie. But then I didn't have time to look it up. And I was like, no, that's not Annie. No, that sounds like Annie.
Yeah,
that's crazy. Yeah, I heard it.
We were touring together and when I wrote that song, so
yeah. That's awesome.
All right. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3.
If you loosen Ellipses, they keep sinking all my ships. Oh, then you're the one who sank my Lusitania. But somehow, don't register as pain at all. Till it finds a crooked vein, it should help us not remember the main.
That's a good one. I love your lyrics. They're really, it's fun to dig into music this way. Cause you know, when you're listening, I don't really tune in on every lyric all the time. Mm. So to actually read them, they're beautiful.
Thank you.
Okay. So I assume Lusitania is a ship. Can you explain it?
There's two ships in the song. There's the main, which was the Spanish-American War, was sunk in the harbor in Cuba, and it's what it was the reason for us to go to war with Spain.
Okay.
And the Lusitania was the reason for us to go to war in World War One. Jeez, man. So it's like it's a metaphor for like conflict in a personal relationship. So it goes from macro like history to personal,
like
You're laying mines along your shore, you know, creating these like it's imagining a couple that's
I can imagine it.
Deliberately wounding each other.
I can definitely imagine.
Deliberately baiting.
You sunk my battleship, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that.
I don't need to explain it too much, do I?
No, you don't have to explain it. But I just such a great word, Lusitania.
Yeah. It's also the name of the Roman name for Portugal.
Oh, cool. Okay. I feel like I'm learning a lot. You read a lot, I think. Am I right about that?
I do read a lot, yeah. Especially as I get older, I read pretty much... Yeah.
It's keep it up. Most people are reading less these days. Mm-hmm. So that's great.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah. Most people just read their phones more. I liked that one. Was that okay?
That was brilliant.
Okay,
it's
cool.
So nice to, I love singing with piano and I don't do it that often, but it brings out something
cool
with the way I sing and that I like.
I love when you get all high and lonesome. You have that quality sometimes in your voice and it gives me chills. It's really... Mm. Really great. Makes me want to do like an old country tune with you.
I know.
Yeah. And that's your next venture, maybe. We'll do a country. Let's do a country record.
Let's do a country record.
That would be really fun.
Yeah. I love the duet, too.
Like, yeah.
Sometimes
I noticed that. You have you sing with a lot of different women, right? Or is there one specific person?
No, it's mostly, I just feel like after, in an album, like after three or four songs from the same point of view, you're ready for someone else.
Yeah, something fresh.
Yeah, because it just feels, no matter how good a record might be, you get a little exhausted from the same point of view. But, and I like what duets bring out in me. Plus there's, when I'm writing the song in my head, there's, you know how like there's a conversation in your head between self one and self two, usually.
Mm-hmm.
And, but since it's in your head, there's no need for pronouns. It's just you talking to you.
Yeah.
So at a certain point, I'm like, wait, who's talking to whom? Who's playing what role? And then I have to like consciously step away and say, okay, this person, this could be a little one act play.
Yeah.
You know, a conversation between two people. And then I like to kind of cast those two people.
I like that.
But it's usually, I figure that out after I've written that kind of song.
I never think to write duets in that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, but do some songs come as internal conversations, no?
I bet they all do. Yeah. I feel like they all do. Yeah. But that's an interesting way to frame it, you know. Thinking about songwriting, I feel like everybody has their own little way of doing it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know what I'm doing until it's almost done.
Yeah, but I think that's the best, most fun way to do it.
Yes.
You know.
Yes, and then that last 20% you have to finish is hard.
Yeah, it can be stressful because you want it to be great, and you don't want it to be incomplete.
And you're using a different part of your brain. You're like trying to.
Yeah, it's true. You're really creative, and like you're capturing everything in spurts, and then you have to sort of wrap it up.
Mm-hmm. You have to make sense to your audience,
exactly.
Or at least. Make some attempt to.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else would you like to try today?
Well, we could try Ellipses if you don't mind me playing along. Of course, we did it earlier and it was kind of awesome for a second, but I think we were talking over it. But
yeah.
I would love to try that one because I think it's so cool, your loop situation. Did that start out of necessity or how did that start?
Kind of. So I got up to the point of having a five-piece band in the late 90s.
And a lot of people.
It was a lot of people, and it was starting to, I kind of felt like my songs were getting inadvertently hijacked by the band, as great as they were.
Well, when you have so many people on stage, everybody has to have something to do.
Right.
And it kind of, it can be hard to capture the same intimacy. Mm-hmm. It, you know, otherwise, like, why are you paying everybody to lay out half the tune, you know?
Right.
So.
But when you've got a big ear, you become adaptable as a player. Like, you hear someone go in a certain direction and you go with them, even though that's not really how you heard it. So to get to that, your question is, like, I kind of disbanded the band for a while and moved out to the middle of nowhere for 2 years. And
where is that?
Western Illinois.
Okay.
Near Dubuque, Iowa, near the Mississippi River.
Wow. Sounds cold.
It was cold, yeah. It was cold and lonely, but it was
By yourself or with a partner?
I was by myself.
Oh, that's intense.
Yeah, it was intense. And I was 29. And I remember talking to this guy who ran this local club. And he's like, this is the point where you should be thinking about going to New York or LA in your career. And I'm like, nope, I'm going to, going to Dubuque, Iowa.
That's a very strange choice.
But anyway, I brought one of these looping pedals with me.
Ah.
And it wasn't like I was going to replace the band. I wasn't thinking that. It allowed me to expand an otherwise linear instrument into one with multiple layers and demo on the fly, kind of. You know, I could play 26 seconds, which is enough to get in 16 bars maybe.
Yeah.
You could choose the verse or the chorus, one or the other.
That's pretty cool, though.
And then I didn't think this anyone would go for this live, but then I was in a situation where I couldn't get a band and I had to play solo and it went pretty well.
People love it. I think it's so fun for people to watch you create something on the fly, you know. It feels like very, very inside the process for people. For me even, like even watching you do it earlier when we were checking the sound, it's kind of incredible. And then it gets so big, you know.
Yeah.
It becomes such a huge sound. From one person.
Does. It works with the violin to a point. It works with this particular one because it fades out the old ideas as you layer new ones in.
Ah, I like that.
Other ones layer everything at the same volume and frequency, so they just build up the same frequencies and it gets congested.
Yeah, that's really key,
and just
I think.
Creatively, it allows you to go, you could end up somewhere completely different than where you started.
That is really... Technology can be so creative.
It can be.
I don't know what the word.
As long as you keep it something kind of fast and dirty like this.
Okay.
Because it's just like, I don't like recording myself at home. I don't know if you feel that. I don't like pressing play and record. But this is kind of like, this is like my four-track demo thing. But it's like, as soon as you want to move on to a new idea, you have to erase you can't get precious about anything. You have to.
That's what's cool about it. It's like analog and spontaneous and improvising. Yeah, I like that.
Yeah. So this tune, Ellipses, is from Echolocations, which is a project I did a few years ago and continue to do. And it's this is just something I completely improvised. That's why when you asked to do it, I had to go listen to it.
Yeah.
It was like I could have done 50 of these.
It sounded
totally
like
different.
It was.
Yeah.
I that's why I said, or something like it. But
yeah.
I do love this recording of it. It's great.
Well, let's just mess around.
I wish I had a loop now. I'm going to try that. I wonder if that would be weird with the piano.
I don't know.
I don't either.
Yeah. Thank you.
That was so fun.
Wasn't it?
Yeah. That is so cool how it fades slowly and it turns into something else completely.
Yeah.
It's like a metamorphosis of that I never thought about it that way.
Yeah. It's just fun to do these sort of polyrhythmic patterns.
There's
endlessly fun to play over.
What is your, I'm not a good gear person, but if we record it, I'll remember it. What do you use? What is that loop pedal?
It's a Line 6 DL4. I just call it the green box.
It's great. Okay, I'm getting one.
Yeah, you should.
I don't know what I'm going to use it with, but I'll get one.
Yeah, go for it.
This was so fun. Can we just go on tour or do something sometime?
Done.
That would be fun.
Let's do it.
Do you ever tour solo? Do you always have different sort of incarnations of what you're doing based on the project you're doing?
Yeah, I'm somewhere between a trio and a quartet now, but there was a time when in those lonely, isolated days out in the country where I would just go straight from this barn I was living in, load up my van and go on tour by myself. And then other times I would be on tour with the band, and then they would have to get back to their families, and I would just, one night it would be a full band, next night it would be solo.
Oh, wow.
No matter what was happening.
Out of necessity, but.
I mean, I could travel light in those days when I was trying to build an audience.
Looking back, I mean, obviously you do what you do, but do you like traveling alone like that? There must be some freedom to it, and also, do you get bored?
Back then, it was an adventure, for sure.
Yeah. You don't really get bored musically if you have the loop pedal like that, I feel like.
No, I would just be, like, so, you know, legally drunk, exhausted from, like, driving eight hours between shows. And
doing all the work yourself.
No tour manager, no, nothing. And but it was kind of, like, I was finally getting an audience, and I was just, like, let's go, you know. And I was just like,
you were,
I felt like I was
excited.
Robin Banks or something. It was like, I felt like an outlaw, basically.
you against the world.
Yeah, crossing state lines.
That's pretty cool.
Merch money in one pocket, show money in the other.
See, I've never done that on my own. Mm. Yeah.
But then always before I was about to have a total either mental or physical breakdown, I would just in time get the support I needed to keep.
Yeah.
You know.
That's great. Yeah, it's not sustainable forever.
But I still like the freedom of playing solo. But it is a bit lonely. Yeah.
Yeah, it can be lonely, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Well, anything, if you do too much of it, you get to where you want to do something else.
Yeah.
Musically, I feel like.
Yeah.
You know, but
sure.
That's cool. All right. Let's do it.
Let's do it. Just a duo? Just, Just.
I've never done a solo. I mean, since those early days of restaurants, I haven't really done a lot of solo shows because I could do like a 20-minute set, but I feel limited by my lack of technique to do fast stuff, I guess.
Right.
Like I'm afraid it'll be all too similar tempo or something. And I really feed off of other people.
Yeah.
I have more fun.
Yeah.
I have a lot more fun playing that way.
Yeah.
So.
I do too.
Well, thank you so much. It was so great to meet you.
My pleasure. I'm so glad you asked me.
I am too. Oh, that was so fun.
Wow, he's really just so good.
So good and so sweet and so like calming.
Mm-hmm.
I'm calmed.
Soothing.
I'm soothed.
His songs are beautiful. I love that his songs are stories.
They're really interesting.
Yeah, the lyrics are just... Yeah,
they're
he's a
like
storyteller.
Interesting lyrics. I wonder what his brain is like on the inside.
Hmm.
Thanks for listening, everyone. Thanks for being my friend,
our
Sarah.
Friend. Oh,
Oda.
I thought you were telling them thanks.
I was, and then I switched it. I didn't know what to
thanks
do.
Thanks to anybody who's
it
my
got
friend
weird
for being my friend.
Thanks to all of you for listening. We love you.
Love you. Thanks for listening. Don't forget to subscribe to Norah Jones is Playing Along wherever you get your podcasts so you never miss a new episode.
This episode was recorded at Golden Hour Sound in Glendale, California by Eric Ruzinski, mixed by Jamie Landry, edited by Sarah Oda, additional engineering by Matthew Vasquez, artwork by Eliza Fry, photography by Shervin Linez, produced by me and my Oda.